He said, Jerrad, you're going to have a million different job titles by the time you die. I'm confident you'll probably have a million different things on your business cards by the time you retire. He said, but you will die a husband, you will die a father, and you will die a disciple. Go crush it at those things. Go do really well at those things.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, this one's going to be a little uncomfortable, isn't it?
Well, speak for yourself.
Well, as a dad, there are many times when I know I don't have it all together.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Yeah. You feel that way sometimes?
All the time.
And the truth is, we've all felt that way at some point trying to raise our kids. I think as men, it's easy for us to act like we do have it figured out. We kind of fake it. But deep inside, many of us wonder if we actually can measure up to the job. Mm-hmm. And the great news is Jesus meets us where we're at, in our imperfections and in our mistakes. Thank the Lord for that. Yeah. So if you're a dad, stay with us for, I think, a fun conversation that should really inspire you to keep going and to be the spiritual leader in your home that you can be.
And our guest is Jerrad Lopes. He's the founder of Dad Tired. It's an online community of men who are striving together to lead their families well. He's married to Layla, and they have three children, and he's written a book called Dad Tired and Loving It, Stumbling Your Way to Spiritual Leadership. And of course, we'll recommend you stop by our website to get your copy, focusonthefamily.com/broadcast.
Jerrad, welcome to Focus on the Family.
Oh man, so good to be here with you guys.
Okay, before we get into your story, I'm just a little curious where you got the title Dad Tired and Loving It. Are you saying parenting just wears you out?
Well, parenting does wear me out.
I'm putting you right up against the wall fast.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I wish that I could say that I had a much more clever way of putting that title together. I had some great epiphany. I didn't. I can kind of dive into the story of how Dad Tired started later. But essentially, I was trying to get some guys into a Facebook group, and Facebook just said, what do you want to title the group? And I thought, I don't know, maybe Dad Tired. It just popped in my mind.
Right.
And so I wasn't thinking at all, let's start a brand or let's start a thing. It was just kind of a spur of the moment.
Huh. Yeah. Well, that's fair. That's the way it's often started, right?
Yeah.
With oh my goodness, what am I going to name this thing? All right. You grew up without a dad.
Yep.
And I know that feeling. What was that like for you? And what impact did it have on you? I know what it had on me in terms of insecurities and other things, but how did not having a dad in your home, and what happened?
Well, I mean, it's still having an impact on me. I'm in my early 30s, and I can confidently say it still affects me to this day.
I'm in my 50s, and I would say, yes, it's still there.
Yeah, absolutely. So my dad left when I was three. He was a professional musician. He is a professional musician. And my mom and dad were never married. I think that they kind of had a fling, had me, ended up having my sister as well. And I think he tried to stick around for as long as he could, and then just realized that the whole dad thing wasn't going to be a good fit for him. And so he left when I was three. I remember as a kid even, I remember playing basketball in my driveway. I have very vivid memories of this. I would play basketball in my driveway, and I would picture him sitting on the steps coaching me. And but he wasn't. He wasn't there. And I just remember thinking, man, like, I can't wait to be a dad one day. And I'm positive that I'm going to be the best dad, and I'm going to be the dad that I always wanted, which hasn't played out the way I thought.
I don't know if my boys have enjoyed me coaching them. So,
yeah.
I mean, right. It's kind of like you can't win, right?
Yeah.
You want to be that dad that you didn't have. And then when you try to, sometimes your kids don't really embrace it.
Well, I mean, that's the heartbeat of Dad Tired is I, in my mind, for years thought I was going to be the best dad in the world. And then I became married and I became a husband and I became a father. And I'm like, oh man, I'm not nearly as good at this as I had pictured that I would be for my whole life. And that's the first time I really realized, like, I'm going to need some help beyond myself here because I don't have what it takes in me to be the kind of dad that I actually want to be or that I feel like God wants me to be.
Yeah. And let's touch on that. You got married pretty young, really, in today's standard, 22.
Mm-hmm.
And Layla, your wife, let's get into a little bit of that insecurity as a guy marrying somebody.
Man.
You didn't have a dad telling you what to expect, what's going to happen. What did you trip on early in your marriage? And then when kids came fast for you, right?
Yeah. So Layla and I met. I was a pastor at a church in Portland. We were hosting a Chris Tomlin concert at the church. Layla came to that concert. This is just the perfect Christian way to meet your spouse.
Ours was Amy Grant.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, yeah. So we're hosting a conference. She walked in, and my job as the pastor that night was to welcome everyone. I thought, I'm really going to make sure she feels welcome.
Discharge your pastoral duties.
Yeah, exactly. A special welcome to Layla, who I don't know yet.
Yeah, exactly. Really want you to feel welcome here. Let me give you a tour of the whole church. So, so I introduced myself to her, and we ended up talking and haven't stopped talking for the last 11 years. But from that day, the day I met her until the day we said I do, was 9 months. So we had a very short courtship.
Yeah.
I just knew if I don't ask her to marry me, someone else is going to really quickly. So I better get on this. So I asked her to marry me. And then we had kids 9 months. She got pregnant 9 months into our marriage. So,
it was fast. A lot of
fast things happening. And again, I thought, I'm going to be a great husband. I'm going to be a great dad. And I always say, nothing exposes your sin better than marriage and having
a kid. That's so true.
And I remember the first time, so just to dive right into kind of the depths here, I remember the first time we were early on in marriage, and I actually confessed to Layla that I had looked at pornography. And I was a pastor at the time. I was a young guy, and I just felt such heaviness, like, man, I am breaking marriage covenant here. Mm. And I need to confess this to my wife. And I did, and I saw the pain in her eyes. Uh-huh. And I thought, man, my sin now carries twice the weight. And thinking through, and I think she was actually pregnant with our first. And I thought, when I was a single guy, it was one thing to sin and kind of deal with the consequences of your sin. But now as a married guy and a soon-to-be father, like my sin carries twice, three times, eventually four, five, six times the weight. Huh. And I'm like, man, I need to figure this thing out because I am not the kind of husband or dad I thought I was going to be. And I just, I mean, you don't realize how much sin you have. You don't realize how much anger you have and how much impatience you have, how selfish you are until you get married and you have kids.
Yeah. I mean, it's so true. And I appreciate that vulnerability. I mean, I'd never thought about it quite that way in terms of the weight of that sin particularly, but good for you. And, you know, I'm sure some women particularly saying, well, how did Layla respond and did you guys get through it and how are you doing in that area?
Well, I mean, I think God is so gracious. You know, Genesis talks about how God creates for Adam a helper, right? And I think that beyond my wife being a soulmate or best friend or a travel partner, a lot of things I thought she would be in marriage, kind of naively going into marriage, beyond all of that, like Layla is a helper to help me become more like Jesus.
Let me ask you this. You know, one of the problems I think with transparency, especially in marriage, you've set it up really well, saying marriage is hard for us sometimes to be honest in, et cetera. And so I remember a guest one time said that men are still like little boys. We hide from those bad things we do. And I don't know that our wives understand that mechanism in us to go hide when we steal the cookie and then you can go from there. Why is that vulnerability so hard for us? Why do we fear being honest with our wives?
Oh, man. You just hit such a nerve because, you know, as I now spend all my days working with men, I literally just said this to the Dad Tired community 2 days ago. The more I interact with men, the more I'm convinced we're all just boys. In adult masks, trying to make our way in this world.
Well, trying to figure out if we're really men.
Yeah.
I mean, that's so true.
I was just in Montana speaking recently. And
they're all real men up there.
That's what I'm saying. These guys were just like, you know, men's men, right? Men's men. And I watched as their walls came down, and some of these guys were trying so hard to fight back tears, and eventually they just broke down. I thought, man, we're all just boys. And to your point, I've heard a lot of guys say, I feel comfortable confessing to God my sins and my shortcomings, but I don't feel comfortable confessing to my wife.
Yeah.
And I think, man, for any wife listening, this is, if you can give your husband one gift, it's to create an environment in your marriage where you can say, husband, I see what God is doing in you, and this is a safe place because I'm partnering with God to help you become the man that God has created you
to be. Well, and in fairness, I get this too from the wives. I mean, we're usually hurting them right in their area of vulnerability.
Right.
Especially in that area you talked about with pornography. I mean, that crushes them as women. I'm not enough for you and all those things. But there's that whole you know, array of things, that emotions that we can wound our wives with, and unintentionally, I think, most of the time. Jerrad, let's go to a story in your book that I thought was really funny because of the title, Satan's Cesspool. I mean, you couldn't have made these things up even better, but this was a great little outdoor experience all of us guys are going to relate to. What happened at Satan's Cesspool, and what is it?
Yeah, so it was right as I was getting out of high school. My friends asked me, hey, Jerrad, do you want to, you know, go on a float down the American River with us in Sacramento? I said, absolutely. I love being on the water, anything that has to do with the water. We had been goofing off, just being a bunch of young, dumb, you know, young guys. And so we're floating, having a good time. And at the end of our trip, my buddy said, hey, do you want to get in the inflatable kayak? And I'll get in your inner tube, we'll swap. And so I said, okay. So I got in his inflatable kayak. And I'm kind of an introvert, sometimes a little bit of a loner. So I'm like, I'm going to go up ahead of everyone and just kind of enjoy some peace. So I'm paddling, very calm, peaceful. I'm just wearing board shorts and flip-flops, no t-shirt on, and I'm just...
No vest, no helmet.
I'm just there to relax and enjoy a nice, calm time on the river. And two guys come up behind me, and I can hear them say, as I'm just kind of in my nirvana, they say, hey man, have you ever done this river before? And I'm like, I turn around, and they're in whitewater kayaks with wetsuits on and life jackets and helmets. And I turn around, and I'm like, what? And they said, have you ever done this river before? And you know, I'm kind of a little punk kid. I'm like, what do you mean done this river before? I've floated plenty of rivers. And they said, well, just be careful because Satan's Cesspool is up ahead. And I thought, oh my gosh. And I feel like
that should have got your attention.
Yeah. Just as they said that, the current picked up, you know? And so all of a sudden I find myself in very fast moving water. And I realize I'm in it. Like there's no way out. And as we get closer to the horizon, I actually see people on shore taking pictures of these kayakers going off of this waterfall.
Oh my!
And so I just think, all right, this is it, man. We're going for it. And I hit that waterfall, man. And immediately my inflatable kayak folds in half. I get tossed out and I get sucked to the bottom and the waterfall is just pushing me under and I'm hitting rocks and I'm just praying for my life. God, please don't let me die. Please don't let me die. Please don't let me die. And I just kind of get pushed out and I'm laying there on shore and I'm like, what in the world just happened? But I tell that story in the book because I think so many guys, actually I think men and women, get into marriage thinking it's going to be a relaxing float down the river, mm-hmm. right? This is just going to be a fun, relaxing time. And I say, you don't need to be married longer than 6 months before you realize this is Satan's Cesspool.
Right, the current's picking up.
This
here.
Is a lot harder than I thought it was going to be.
Well, it's a great analogy. Yeah. I mean, it really is. One of those things you mention in your book is time. And, you know, I think that would be my thing. I don't think it's an ego thing. I think for me, I could just get so busy and I neglect. And I remember a story, and I'd like you to react to this and then talk about yourself as a pastor those 11 years and how you tried to divide your time between people pulling on you and your family, your own family. But I remember this youth pastor told me once, he said, you know, I was really busy at this time. I had a 4-year-old daughter. I came home from a youth event. I needed to shower quickly and get back to the church in order to have a teen get together. And my 4-year-old daughter came up to me wanting to hug me. And I said to her, I'm sorry, honey, I got to go teach people about Jesus. And she said, well, Daddy, when are you going to teach me about Jesus? Isn't that a cutting line? Jeez. I mean, out of the mouth of a babe, right? Yeah. And so he quit that job and got on a 8-to-5 job at GM in Detroit there so he could be home at night to be the father to that little girl. But that's such a great example, especially with ministry and then, you know, a different vocation that allows you to be there. Yep. Speak to that.
Well, I think so many guys struggle with this. I think part of it has to do with we feel better oftentimes at our jobs than we do at home. I can go to work and get rewarded. I have a paycheck coming in. A boss might pat me on the back, said you did a good job.
It's today. A pretty calm river.
Right. It's a calm
most
river.
Most of the time.
Exactly. And I kind of know what I'm doing and I know it's expected of me. And then when guys get home, they don't quite know their role as husband and dad. And so oftentimes I don't know if it's a time thing. Honestly, I don't know if you ask guys, you know, they say, well, I don't have enough time to spend with my family and kids. I'm working so much. But you also have time to play fantasy football, and you're also watching some Netflix, and you're on your phone
a ton. So you're kind of hiding.
Yeah, you're hiding. You got time, man. You got time. I think you just feel more comfortable at work. And so you have to have an honest conversation with yourself, like, why don't I want to be home and want to give the intentionality to my wife and kids that they really want from me?
Well, and that was your dilemma, right? I mean, when you were pastor these 11 years, you were noticing things at home weren't going quite right. Explain your personal story in that regard.
Yeah. So for me, I had, you know, I had to come to the conclusion, like, okay, this isn't a time issue. This is an intentionality issue. And I had a mentor tell me one time, Jerrad, he said, Jerrad, you're going to have a million different job titles by the time you die. I'm confident you'll probably have a million different things on your business cards by the time you retire. He said, but you will die a husband, you will die a father, and you will die a disciple. Go crush it at those things. Go do really well at those.
What are those three again?
Husband, father, disciple. Yeah. Those will go with you to the grave.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And for him, he was really successful in business. And I thought, man, okay, if this is priority to him, I want to make this priority for me.
Yeah. Our guest today on Focus on the Family is Jerrad Lopes, and he's written a book called Dad Tired and Loving It, Stumbling Your Way to Spiritual Leadership, full of great stories and vulnerabilities we've heard thus far in the program today. Stop by our website to get a copy of that book. It's focusonthefamily.com/broadcast.
Jerrad, I love this next question because I know where it's going, but you had an experience as a dad that helps, I think most men relate to you. You and your kids went off to your reading club or something that you were anticipating. What happened, and did your wife say you fool?
Oh my gosh. Well, yeah.
One of many times she said.
Yeah.
But what happened? It's great.
Well, so we at the local elementary school, they were doing a community reading night. So firefighters, cops, dentists, all these people were coming to read stories to the kids. So Layla was working, so she said, Jerrad, will you take the kids? I said, sure. So I show up to the school and it's locked, and there's hardly any cars in the parking lot. So I text her. I'm like, are you sure this is, you know, it's tonight? She said, 100% sure. So I'm trying to get into all the doors. Everything's locked. So I go around the back of the building, and she said, you know, they're having pizza, they're having cupcakes, and they're reading stories. So I get to the back of the building, and I see out on the field, there's some adults out there and some kids, and there's pizza, cupcakes. And so I think, okay, I text her. I said, okay, I found it. I'm here. So my kids are, I'm dishing them up all this pizza and cupcakes, and we're having a great time, and they're playing. I'm just kind of sitting, and I feel awkward. I feel like people are staring at me. You know how you just kind of sense sometimes, and you're like, you don't feel, you're out of place. And I've taught, you know, sometimes I'll teach at churches and stuff. So I thought maybe they've recognized me from one time I taught at church or something. But I just keep getting these side-eye looks. And all of a sudden, we're there for probably a half hour. The kids are playing. I've had now two portions of pizza and cupcakes.
It was good pizza.
Yeah. And all of a sudden, one of the parents yells, hey, kids, gather around. Coach is going to give out the awards now. And my heart sank, and I realized, this is not the community reading night. I have crashed an end-of-the-year soccer party. And I've been eating all of their pizza and cupcakes, and they're wondering, who is this dad here that's not part of the team?
Right.
And so I yell at my kids. I'm like, hey, come in. And they get in, and I kind of huddle them around. I'm like, hey, you want to race to the car? And
they say, first one wins something big.
So they said, yeah. So we all just run to the car, and then we slam the door, and we're laughing. And I'm just, they have no idea what's going on, right? But I just cowered out and totally ran away. But the reason I tell that story in the book is, man, there are so many times that we are going to stumble and trip our way up in fatherhood. You know, like this is the whole fatherhood journey, is just constantly making mistakes and adapting.
Well, and I think a good sense of humor helps, obviously. Oh, and yeah. I think your kids learn so much through that, too. I mean, everybody's going to make mistakes. Jesus still loves us, even when it's all good stuff. Let's talk about devotions with our children. Yeah. I mean, that's one of the things, you know, I think every Christian home, this becomes a little bit of the battle between mom and dad, not in front of the kids, hopefully, but, you know, honey, are you going to do something tonight with the kids, some spiritual thing? Have you ever heard that?
Oh, my gosh. I hear it daily in our Facebook group and on our online community.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I think that prompting is a good thing. I'm not getting on wives for reminding us that it'd be good to teach the kids something spiritual. But there is, I think, generally with men and women, there is a different approach to doing this. I mean, my wife's a great example. She was, you know, chemistry major, so she's really sorted out. I mean, she's got her plan. She's going to go in tonight. It's going to be 30 minutes.
She's smarter than you.
She's smarter than me. Saying. Absolutely. Okay. There's no doubt about that. She's much higher on the SAT. But, you know, the point of that is that she wants something a little more formal. And then I'm a guy driving down the road, and I see some illustration, and I'll talk to the boys. You know, that's just like Proverbs 3, right? And I use moments to really talk about Scripture and how that applies. I think both are valid. Neither is invalid, but we tend to esteem things differently. So how do we manage that as men? How do we manage, you know, mom's expectation of doing something more formal, and then we're not meeting it?
Well, I mean, what you just said is such a beautiful example, because look at what Jesus did. He did both.
Right.
He had the times where they were studying the scripture, and then they would take the scripture and apply them in real life. Go and love your enemies. If somebody, how often should you forgive someone? One of his disciples asked, and he basically said, "You never stop forgiving." Right. And so they're hearing this in the scripture, and then someone comes to arrest Jesus, and that disciple is now chopping the ear off the guy,
right.
And Jesus is saying, "Put your sword away." Yeah, so he's doing both. Let me teach you what the scriptures say about how to follow Jesus, and now let me show you how to put those into practice. And this is what a dad that wants to be a spiritual leader does both. We study God's word. We have times where we actually break open the Bible and read, but then I'm using every opportunity that I possibly can.
Let me ask you, since you have so many men that you're working with and doing this better, how do we respond to our wives? You know, how do we communicate, okay, I hear you, honey, don't fret, I got it, and I'll do something tonight, but can I do it the way I would want to do it? Or how do you suggest that conversation go?
Yeah, well, I mean, I should probably ask you guys that question.
Well, I'm laying it at your feet, man.
Even married longer than me, but I think in any question, we respond to our wives with grace. Well, there's always a question behind the question, or there's always a statement behind the statement. So if my wife is saying, hey, you should do this, I want to say, what's the real issue? Like, what are you really wanting here?
And they're going to say, I believe, I'm worried that the kids aren't in the right place spiritually. And that's a good concern. That's
exactly. Yeah. And so what I want to do is either one, say, I'm not actually stepping up as a good spiritual leader. And I'm sorry, babe, I need to repent that I have put this area that's really important to you. And I want it to be important to me. I've put it aside and I'm sorry. So that would actually be the first step for a husband, is to actually repent to his wife and to step into that. And then second, say, can you help me figure out how this would be a good area for me to grow in and for us to lead our kids? I want to be the spiritual leader. I'm not sure quite how to do that, and I'm open to feedback on this.
Yeah, I was going to ask, just as you're speaking there, I'm thinking about your statement, Jerrad, that we're all little boys in man masks. So how about the guy that wants to do what you're saying, but he doesn't have a clue on really how to take that first step? What are you finding out with guys that works well?
Well, so that's majority of guys. I mean, every guy in our dad tired community, that's what they're saying. If you go, it's interesting right now. If you go to the park, if I go to any park right now, there are going to be dads who are playing with their kids, going down the slide. There are going to be dads who are changing diapers, who are doing more things than most of our dads did. Right? They're swinging the pendulum hard the other way, and so we have a lot of really engaged dads. But if you ask that dad, do you feel like the spiritual leader of your home? Do you feel like you know how to point your family to Jesus? They would say, no, I don't. I don't know where to begin. And that's what we're trying to do. Like with Dad Tire, we're trying to equip guys, give them actual very practical tools so they can step into that role as the spiritual leader.
You know, Jerrad, you do such a good job in the book explaining to guys how to turn those situations into spiritual moments. I think you had, this is really funny because I could relate to this. You had something going on with the water again. You love water, you said.
I love water.
And your kids and a cell phone or two cell phones or maybe 20 cell phones.
Oh, it's
what
a painful
happened?
Incident. Look at his face.
Yeah, well, it's a long story, so I'll give you the short version. But we were fishing. I had my family in town. We were fishing at a dock. My sister caught a fish. She was so excited. She hadn't caught a fish since she was a little girl. She said, take a picture, pulled out my phone, took a picture, went to put the phone back in my pocket. It fell into the river. Oh. So that was the 2 days later, I take my daughter out and my son fishing. And my daughter says, I'm bored, Daddy. Can I play on your phone? I'm like, no, don't you remember what just happened? She said, Daddy, please. So I give in to her sweet little
Daddy,
attitude.
Please,
yeah.
Daddy.
Hand her the phone, put her in the middle of this big dock. She could drop the phone in any direction and it's not going to land in the water. Well, my little girl at that time, I think she was, 4 or 5 years old. Her patience tank had run empty that day because the internet wasn't moving fast enough for her little Peppa Pig video or whatever she was watching. And in her frustration, she took that brand new iPhone that I had just bought 2 days earlier with cash, no insurance, and she threw that thing as far as she could into the middle of the river. And I always say this, that was the most embarrassing moment of my parenting journey thus far, as how much I yelled at her. I'm confident people were calling the cops, like, something's going on down there. But I was so furious.
You were, like $1,000 furious?
Exactly, yeah.
Well, again, it just shows how, the imperfections that we have. And I think that's so much of the battle for some of us. I mean, if you're a type A kind of guy, you're in trouble. Because God's coming to root that out. And it's not your wife. It's not your kids. It's the Lord working through them, maybe, to say, I got a little different approach to life for you, type A dad, and here's how it's going to happen, right?
Well, yeah. So we oftentimes we think that our kids and our wife, you know, we're there to serve them and we're there to help shape them, especially our kids. Man, God is using, every dad knows this, God is using our kids to help us make us more like Him.
So when you look at the characters in Scripture in the book, you speak to your favorite, and I think that's Peter. So I think Peter's a good, most guys like Peter because he's messing up all the time. And we relate to that. That's why we say we like Peter, because we're like Peter, right? So how does Peter relate to your daily troubles, and why do you identify with him so much?
Well, Peter always says, you know, ready, fire, aim. That's Peter.
he
says something, and then later he's getting rebuked by Jesus, and yet he's Jesus, one of Jesus' closest friends.
Right? He's going to build the church on him.
Yeah, it's incredible. He has an incredible relationship with Jesus, and yet he's just always putting his foot in his mouth. And, you know, he says to Jesus, he pulls him aside and says, I just want you to know I'm never going to deny you, right? I'm never going to leave you. That night, he denied him three times. So he's a mess, and I look at myself, and I'm like, how often? I was just praying this morning, God, man, I'm drawn to you, and I felt like the prodigal son who runs to the father and has the feast with the father, and then that night I'm sneaking back out.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, man, I just so relate to that, to what Peter was going through, this constantly just fumbling up my journey of trying to fall in love with Jesus.
Well, it captures the spirit of a man. I mean, that really is a man. You know, I want to be this, but quietly I'm not that. Mm-hmm. And that's the battle. That's the struggle. I know what I should be when it comes to all these behaviors and things, but I'm not measuring up. And Jerrad, you're a pastor, so you know this, but I mean, this is where Jesus has to come into your life as a man and repair those breaches that you've had for whatever reason, the reason you can't measure up, your insecurities, your lack of confidence, whatever it might be. And I'd say, make a pitch right now to the guy, the father, and the husband who isn't measuring up, what do they got to do first thing spiritually to move in the right direction?
So I think there are a lot of guys who aren't leading their families because they're ignorant. They did not have a leader to show them, a dad, somebody to teach them that. But I think there are more guys who know what they should be doing and they're not doing it because they are burdened with shame. Mm-hmm. I think there are so many guys who are paralyzed by their shame and they feel like, how could I lead my family to a God that I don't personally feel close to? And going back to Peter, Peter denied that he even knew Jesus. There's a powerful moment where Peter looks at Jesus as he's denying him, right? The two look at each other. They make eye contact. And then Jesus dies. That's a bad day for Peter.
Yeah.
That's a real bad day. The next time Peter sees Jesus, Jesus has breakfast ready for him. After he has risen up again, he has breakfast ready for him. Peter comes off the boat from fishing, and Jesus cooks him breakfast. The reason I tell that story is because there are a lot of guys who think, I need to hide from God because I have way too much shame. And the truth is, that is not the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible, on your very worst day, has breakfast ready for you.
Yeah,
so I would tell that guy, man, turn away from your shame because there's a God who really, really wants to be near you. Think about Jesus, our God in the Garden of Eden. What was God doing on the worst day of history as all of creation was collapsing? He was taking a walk. God can handle your worst day. So I would tell that guy, man, if you feel like you're too dark in shame, turn to Jesus. The God of the Bible wants to be near you.
Yeah. And you have so many great illustrations of the book. I want to end on a pretty funny story, how God got your attention about doing ministry in your community. You wanted to sell a bed, but you had it all figured out how you're going to do this because it was heavy. I mean, you're making all the right guy measurements here. Fill us in on that story.
So I had been in the season where I really wanted God to show up and do miraculous things. I was just praying, God, show up, show off your glory. And during this time, we were moving from an apartment to a home, and we had got everything out of this third-story apartment, no elevator, so everything on stairs. And so we had this very heavy bed frame. It was the last thing to move. And I told my wife, I don't want to move this thing. It's a hassle. So I put it online for sale, and I put in there, whoever buys this, you need to show up, you know, be ready to haul it yourself. That's very heavy. So this guy shows up. He said he wants to buy it, and he shows up, and he's by himself. And I'm like, dude, what are you doing? What are you doing? I said, it's very heavy. You got to show up. So anyway, I'm frustrated already at the transaction. Okay, so we're sitting there, and I'm telling him, here's how the bed frame's broken down, how you're going to want to put it together. And as I'm saying all this to him, I just feel the prompting by the Spirit, give him the bed. Give him the bed frame. And I'm like,
insult to injury, right?
Yeah. I'm like, no. I'm like, absolutely not. I'm not giving him the bed frame.
Guy.
No. Yeah.
One. You brought some friends, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. I don't want to haul this thing down and now I'm not going to get money for it. So, absolutely not. I'm not going to do this. Well, the Spirit, you know, over and over and over and just pushing me. And eventually I wasn't even a cheerful giver. I was reluctant. I was mad. I'm like, hey man, you can have the bed frame. I'm mad. I'm like, you can have the bed frame. He said, oh my gosh, what? And I try to make it spiritual. I'm like, you know, I'm blessed to be a blessing. I try to make it all Christian, but we're hauling this heavy bed frame down three flights of stairs. And he stops and he says, hey man, I just want you to know my wife just served me with divorce papers and I don't have any furniture. And so the fact that you're giving me this is like, it's really helpful. Mm-hmm. And dude, I just felt like I had been praying that God would show off his glory. And he was using a bed frame, even in my reluctance, to bring the kingdom of heaven down here to earth.
To this guy. Well, you know, again, I appreciate that vulnerability. I think this is a guy's life. This is what we are as husbands and fathers. And we're, you know, so often we're misfits because we're not perfect in this life. And we're certainly looking forward to the next. But you've done a wonderful job pulling these thoughts together. Jerrad, I appreciate, again, your honesty. And we're all learning as we go, right? I mean, that's the bottom line. And I would like for you, our listeners, viewers on YouTube, get a copy of Dad Tired and Loving It. I think it has all the right mixes for us of humor, stories like you've heard, and, you know, admonitions to get it going and do the right thing. So I think it's that wonderful blend. If you can make a gift of any amount to Focus on the Family, we'll say thank you by sending you a copy of the book. And as I often do, I trust that people are partnering with us in ministry. If you can't afford it, get in touch with us. We'll get it into your hands. Just like the bed frame, right? We'll send you the book so you can read it, and we'll trust others will cover the cost of that. But Jerrad, thanks again for being with us. Really, really good stuff.
It was great to be here. Thank you.
So donate today and get your copy of Dad Tired and Loving It when you call 800, the letter A in the word family, or online at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast. And while you're at the website, be sure to download our mobile app. The new Focus on the Family mobile app has lots of great content, this broadcast, and so much more. And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.